You're tuned in to Nerd Overload, your weekly pop and geek culture show covering movies, TV, games, and comics. Now your hosts, Cody Pinnick, Sam Dunham, and Josh Harrison.
Hey everybody, welcome to Nerd Overload, the pop and geek culture show that's coming at you with a new episode. But don't worry, my friend, we can get through this together. I'm Cody, and I'll be controlled by an AI model.
I am Sam.
I am Josh. This is weird.
And I'm Samantha.
We have a great show for you this week. Thank you all for tuning in once again on this fine Saturday or whenever you happen to be listening to this. We have a bunch of news to go over, but first, let's talk about some things we have been checking out.
Check it out.
You know what? The pause between my thing and saying check it out is getting longer every episode. Eventually, we're going to get to one where it's just like the entire first half of the show is just dead air waiting for me to say check it out.
Well, you got to leave them in anticipation.
Patient, yes. All right. So things we've been doing. So the main thing I've been doing is I checked out new phone game that has been hotly anticipated for a while now, Final Fantasy VII Ever Crisis. That's something we actually talked about on the show, God, must have been like a year or so ago.
A couple times.
Yeah, a couple times. But it's basically it's kind of like a Cliff Notes version of all of the Final Fantasy VII branded games kind of rolled together.
Yeah, the main game and adjacent materials.
Yeah, which there are a lot of.
Yeah.
It's kind of interesting. I've only played through the first little bit, but I mean, it plays pretty well for a phone game.
Yeah, I played up until it like takes the wheels off, basically.
Basically, yeah.
The training wheels off.
Essentially, same here. And I think it's interesting that they're kind of going in chapters with everything, that you can kind of jump around a little bit if you'd like, from one game, one storyline to another. And I think it's interesting that they're actually going to be coming up with some sort of plot for the First Soldier, which was just an MMO.
It was a
battle royale game with very little plot to it.
Yeah, it was a Fortnite.
Yeah, but they're actually making a plot to go along with it, and it's going to have a playable version of Advent Children in it, which is kind of neat. Which is the first time that because that was a movie.
Yeah.
That was just a
hopefully
DVD
they can
movie.
Make it make more sense.
I hope so, because boy, it didn't make much sense.
No, it really didn't.
Looked neat, but
oh, it's a beautifully animated movie.
Yeah, but it just made no sense.
It looks like they're going to go into Sephiroth's past too.
Apparently, one of the First Soldier.
Oh, it has Sephiroth, baby Sephiroth. Apparently.
It has new recruit Sephiroth in it. Yeah, he is one of the first. I think it's something like First Soldier was supposedly about the first round of Mako-infused, magic-infused soldiers, and Sephiroth was one of those first round of test subjects, I guess, kind of, sort of. And that's what that's going to go into, which is kind of cool. It also has a lot of gacha mechanics where you can put so much real world dollars into it. I refuse to do so.
You can give Square Enix so much of your hard earned money.
No matter how cool those weapons and costumes look, I have zero interest in actually putting money into this thing.
Is there costumes you can get in the gacha?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right now they're running a special on a samurai themed cloud.
Oh, man.
A samurai-themed cloud with a Sephiroth sword and a samurai-themed Barret. Apparently, in the test version, some players were able to get randomly the Cloud in Drag.
Nice.
Costume that you could just play as Cloud in Drag from that one scene in Final Fantasy VII.
That's illegal in some states.
From these days. But yeah, it's interesting. It's fun. And so far it's free. So
yeah, it's got a nice turn-based battle system. That's not, it's not the same as the games, but it's like has a similar feel to it.
It kind of has.
Guess.
Yeah. And it's interesting that you're only playing as one character. So the rest of your party is AI controlled. The only thing you do with them is you time when, once they've hit their limit break, you can time when to activate their limit break. But otherwise, they kind of do their own thing. And that's kind of cool. I mean, it kind of takes a lot of the onus, a lot of the, you know, time and energy off of it. So that you could just sit and, you know,
watch it do its thing.
Yeah, watch it do its thing for the most part.
The main conceit of the battle system is you have the active time gauge.
Yeah.
And, like, you wait for it to go up to certain levels to be able to use certain moves. So, like, maybe your more powerful one, you have to wait a little longer than
right.
the other ones. Or
yeah.
healing takes a little longer. So,
yeah.
So use the right things at the right time.
Yep. And all of the in-battle sprites look like the new, the updated, or at least as close as they can get on a cell phone.
Yeah, it looks really mm-hmm. nice. The design is very similar to the remake.
Remake, yeah. And the out-of-battle ones look like very nicely updated versions of the PlayStation 1. The blocky.
Yeah, they're kind of chibi looking.
Yeah, but they're smooth. They look really nice. They don't they're not like the weird hard edges. They actually look really, really good.
I do remember when I played the original Final Fantasy VII when I was a kid, I was like, I wish this had more like actual cutscenes because there's only like two.
Instead of watching these people who look like melted Lego minifigs.
Yeah.
Scoot around.
Have these dramatic moments.
Yes.
Yeah. I've actually been playing around with mods of Final Fantasy VII, the original, on the PC. Apparently, people have gone through and added like a million different mods to the game to like stuff like quality of life improvements, but also they've made Jessie playable for the first couple missions.
Nice.
And she's basically a Tifa clone, basically, and all the levels transfer over to Tifa once you get her. But they've given her an actual in-game model and stuff that you can use.
Everybody loves Jessie Raspberry.
She's great. And what else did they do? There's like, they went through and painstakingly AI up-resed every static background in the game, so everything looks crisp and not like pixely and stuff like that. They've done that.
They've added voice acting. You can get full fan-done voice acting for the entire game.
Yeah, and it's pretty good. It's not the best, but it's pretty okay.
It's good for the price.
Yeah, yeah. And like just updated models, updated everything. It's really well done. Of course, I have too many mods on it right now and it crashes at the first battle. So I got to figure out which one's breaking things. But up until a point, everything looked really cool. So
it's like when I tried to install all of the expansions for The Sims, I think two at once.
Oh, yeah.
And it took like 10 minutes, 10 solid minutes to load, and then it would immediately crash.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I've done that with The Sims 3 before, because it's just too much. It just is like, no.
This is too much, man.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's pretty much what I've been checking out this week. Otherwise, I've been watching, you know, just random stuff on YouTube. And
if you watch the Quentin reviews, 6 hours.
I have not sat to watch it yet. I need to set aside the time. That's
six hours of what?
It's 6 hours. Yeah.
I've watched about four of the six.
Yeah. So Quentin Reviews does a lot of really long, super, super long form deep dives into, well, his current thing is like Nickelodeon teen sitcoms.
Oh.
And this is part two of Sam and Cat. He's already done a couple of Victorious and a couple of
iCarly.
And now it's the spinoff with both of the secondary characters from those together in their own show. And yeah,
it's just wild to see all the dumb crap that they did on those shows.
Oh yeah.
I didn't watch them.
I didn't either.
Idea.
Yeah. I didn't know.
I had no idea how messed up they really are.
Well, that's what happens when you have a show creator and showrunner that has, he's into certain things, and he likes to put them on screen for everyone to see.
Allegedly?
Allegedly? Let's just put it this way. The show Sam and Cat, and by extension, iCarly and Victorious, has a lot of things to do with putting stuff on feet, like gel, and I think there was an episode with ketchup, and it was like, this isn't even hiding it.
Yeah. they try to put it off as like, this is just a wacky, funny kids thing that kids will think is funny. And it's like, no.
No, it's just a bunch of foot stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It reminds me of this this picture I have saved on my phone that I like to throw.
No. You can keep that to yourself.
It's a family show.
No. It is like, it's like some like old like TV show like episode title stinger. And it said, like, the writer's thinly veiled fetish.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Like every episode of Totally Spies.
Yeah.
I liked Totally Spies. Me and my sister used to watch that a lot together.
It was a cute show.
It was a cute show.
I think it's getting a new season.
It's getting a remake.
But all of the voice actors won't be returning because it's non-union.
Non-union,
so
yeah.
Jennifer Hale's not going to be there.
Womp womp.
Yeah.
Yep. Don't cross picket lines.
Anyway. Yeah, Josh, what have you been doing? What have you been up to?
A whole lot. Really, honestly, a whole lot of nothing.
Well, that doesn't make for a good
joke. I know. We've been watching a lot of South Park.
Continuing the South Park trend.
Yeah, continuing the South Park. The Boondocks. Going back through that again.
Okay, sure. Yeah.
God, I love that show. It's so messed up.
Well, once you finish that, you have to go to the Black Dynamite animated series because it's done by the same animation studio.
And it's really good,
too. It's really good. That reminds me, they're about ready to release The Outlaw Johnny Black, which is the spiritual sequel to Black Dynamite.
Nice.
It doesn't feature, I mean, it's Michael Jai White directing and writing it, and it's almost all the same actors from Black Dynamite. It's not the Black Dynamite character. It's a Western, but my theory is Black Dynamite had a weird meta universe built around it where it was, you're not watching the adventures of Black Dynamite, you're watching an old football star trying to be an actor in a blaxploitation film, and my theory is this is that same former football player turned actor is now in a spaghetti western.
Nice. I'll be excited to see that.
It's great. Yeah, if it's even two-thirds as good as Black Dynamite, then it's another hit.
Yeah,
I told you not to interrupt my kung fu. I threw that from the other room. I love that movie.
It's such a good movie. Speaking of movies, we watched the new Turtles movie. Mayhem.
How is it?
It's really good. It was really fun and good. Really cute. It changes the origin stories a little bit, but in ways that make it make more sense.
Oh, that's cool. That's fine.
Splinter is not like a rat that learned karate anymore. Okay. Now he's a rat that got into the mutagen. And then started raising the turtles, then decided we got to do something to protect ourselves. So they all learned ninjutsu together.
Interesting. Okay. That's an interesting take.
So he wasn't a rat doing karate in his cage, in the old movie.
Or a man who became a rat. It depends on what thing you're watching.
Or the reincarnated spirit of a samurai warrior.
Yeah.
Because that's the comics now.
Yeah. He could still be that.
Okay, yeah.
That's still possible.
Okay.
But all the mutant characters and monsters and stuff were so good and fun.
Cool.
And it was refreshing to see a Turtles movie that does not involve the Shredder or Krang in any way.
Oh, good.
It's all just the mutants. The main villain is Superfly, who's voiced by, it's Ice Cube, right? Yeah, and he does a really good job.
Awesome.
As an evil fly. Paul Rudd is funny as Mondo Gecko.
Great. I think that might be like one of the first times Mondo Gecko has been
outside of the comics. Yeah.
Yeah, outside of the comics, because Mondo Gecko was an action figure exclusive forever because they just had a model like a model for a Gecko action figure. And they're like, well, maybe he's a turtle character. I don't know.
Well, it's like back in the day, man. It's like Street Sharks and stuff. They just threw everything against the wall to see
what happens. Yeah.
What they would get. It's like, well, we have all these characters. I mean, we can't just have, you know, 100 different versions of Turtles, which they did anyway.
He's absolutely the Poochie character that you would think he is.
Okay, perfect.
And Michelangelo loves him, which is like,
oh, I'm sure. Yeah, no, that makes sense.
The kids playing the Turtles who sound like actual teenagers, they're all very good.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of that, like, we're constantly talking over each other humor that for some reason, like, hits me right in the funny bone every time.
Okay, cool, cool. How are Seth Rogen and John Cena as
Bebop and Rocksteady?
Bebop and Rocksteady.
They didn't really do a whole lot with them. They had couple lines, but they were just kind of there, I felt like.
Oh, it's kind of like it's I saw them and I clapped kind of thing.
Well, no, they're part of like the bunch of mutants, but they don't stand out a whole lot in the crowd.
Gotcha, gotcha. Well, you know what? They're some of the more popular mainstays, I suppose. So yeah, if they're trying to promote characters,
they were the primary henchmen for the '80s cartoon. So
yeah,
the soundtrack's interesting.
They have a chase scene that's completely to the four non-blondes, so that what's going on.
Really?
But it is the version from the He-Man YouTube video.
Oh, no way!
Like, it's not even the actual song. It's that recording.
That's so good.
It's the He-Man one?
Yeah.
Oh, that's so great.
It's hilarious and somehow, like, works really well.
And he prayed!
Oh, that's awesome. He has a really frantic energy that matches the frantic energy of the chase scene.
Fantastic.
I did see an article today that because the movie was so successful, it's getting a sequel in video game form.
And just a regular sequel, too. I looked it up. It is getting a sequel and a series on Nickelodeon, too.
Trent Reznor did the music.
Yeah, Trent Reznor did the soundtrack, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Wow. And the animation's really good. I mean, it came from the Mitchells versus the Machines folks.
Yeah, it has a very unique style to it, a really hand-drawn looking style.
Say, it kind of reminds me of like Spider-Verse.
It's not as good looking as Spider-Verse, but it is also its own thing.
No, that's good. That's good.
From the trailers, it almost looks like they 3D animated stuff that you would draw on your trapper.
Yeah, it kind of has that vibe.
Yeah, like in high school or junior high, you'd draw a bunch of weird monster guys and then they animated them. That's cool. That's really cool.
And the blocky S's.
Mm-hmm. I like how they made it so the turtles want to go to school.
Okay.
Which is like, they should want to go to school. They're teenagers.
They're teens, yeah.
It's like the first turtles thing that's ever existed.
They want to like be like normal people.
Yeah. Where they recognize that they are in fact teenagers and they would want to fit in.
And
yeah.
Learn.
It almost feels like almost every Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles franchise to this point, the turtles, they're in their 20s. They're played as though they're in their 20s.
Yeah.
They're all like adults.
Or like teenage as in 18, 19.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I prefer this take, honestly. I think they are canonically 15, they said. Like, that just makes sense to me.
Makes more sense. It makes it more fun.
Yeah.
Because, teens are going to be reckless. You know, they're going to go out and do stuff and yahoo, wahoo, run around, whatever.
It's being a mutant turtle person is a great metaphor for the awkwardness of being a teenager.
Sure, yeah.
Have you talked about that movie watched on Shudder?
No, I haven't talked about that. That movie was weird.
Well, let's talk about it. Let's talk about a weird bird movie.
Hatching? I have to look up what it was called real quick.
Okay.
Yeah, it's called Hatching, and it's about a family where the mom is a huge like Instagram influencer.
I've heard of this one.
And is pressuring her daughter a whole lot. To do
the same thing?
No, to just be successful at everything. And she's a gymnast and she has to work real hard to be
overbearing.
The best gymnast.
She's overbearing.
Yeah.
Helicopter mom.
And she has a dream that she finds an egg in the woods and then wakes up with the egg. Isn't that how it goes down? Wakes up with the egg and then like kind of incubates it, like puts it in a pillow and it hatches out like a human bird hybrid monster.
Mm-hmm.
And then has to keep that a secret. And the bird monster is terrifying. The special effects are so good.
Like, well, doesn't I think I've read about this. The human bird monster ends up taking on aspects of the kid, right?
Yeah, it basically slowly starts turning into her.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's a metaphor for things.
Sure, yeah. But no, that's
kind of a heavy-handed one, but a good one nonetheless.
I've wanted to see this one. Yeah, yeah. Because like I said, I've read about it. I've read reviews of it, and it sounds really
It is good. Really good, and it's worth it just for the bird monster alone, honestly. Mm-hmm. I read I think it was a Polygon article where they like consulted with like Star Wars people and like high up special effects people about making this bird monster.
Really?
And it shows.
Oh, that's awesome.
It's very creepy.
Excellent. Excellent.
There's a bird monster right there. Like you never, you know.
Yeah, you don't question that it's not real. Yeah.
Gotcha.
But yeah, that was good. Did we watch anything else? Oh, I've played a lot of Starfield.
Yeah, tell me about Starfield. Does he hate Mondays?
Oh, yeah.
Does he love lasagna?
Yeah.
Space lasagna, space Monday.
Does he,
It's freeze-dried lasagna.
Does he mail Galaxy Nurmal to the planet Abu Dhabi? That was a deep pull. I had to stretch for that one, yeah. but I'm proud of it.
But Bethesda game something. I forget their studio.
Whatever they, yeah.
Bethesda. Is this Bethesda?
Bethesda, Microsoft now, kind of.
Yeah. Their new game, it's called Starfield. It's about being a spaceman traveling around in space. The main conceit so far, and it's a pretty weak one story-wise, is that there's these artifacts they keep finding around the galaxy that when you touch them, they make you have a 2001 freak out.
Oh, cool. Okay, so there's like space babies and stuff.
Well, not,
or like,
it's just
not
colors,
exactly,
it's
but just like
colors and,
gotcha.
And stars,
yeah.
And
okay.
Stuff. And you got to go find all of those and then put them together for something. I'm not that far along yet to figure out.
Yeah,
exactly
you got to get the stones together so the fifth element can keep the darkness at bay.
Yeah,
Thanos can snap half the universe.
Yeah, it's really trod ground.
Well, yeah. Also it's a Bethesda game.
And I did
because it's a Bethesda game. I mean, it's going to be well trod ground.
Yeah. After you, it's kind of spoilers, but it's also a gameplay mechanic. Like once you get enough of them and you find this temple, like it gives you a magic power.
Okay.
Like it gave me the ability to create a zero gravity area for a small amount of time.
Hmm.
So there's some sort of magic. There's a magic power system involved too.
So it's like Skyrim, but space.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Like instead of learning the words, you get the, you go
you
to
find
the temple.
You find the artifacts.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I mean, it sounds like an interesting conceit for a game.
Yeah. I mean, it's fun. It is space Fallout. Like,
yeah.
It is a Bethesda game through and through. If you go into it not expecting it to be anything more than that, you're probably going to have a pretty good time. I mean, I've enjoyed it, and I've enjoyed a Fallout to a lesser extent in Elder Scrolls throughout my gaming career.
I've heard this one has less bugs this time around because of that little extra bit of Microsoft polish.
Yeah, I haven't had anything really weird happen.
Because Bethesda games, historically, on launch...
Are buggy.
Are, or even now, with Skyrim, are incredibly buggy.
I did see one article where they talked about how sometimes there's a bug where your crew will sit outside the ship.
I've had it crash on me once.
Okay.
Like straight back to the Xbox dashboard.
Yeah.
But I just reloaded my save and it was fine. It wasn't like a game breaker.
Cool.
Yeah, I mean everybody still has like those same animations and it's just looks like a bunch of people walking
wooden
around.
People.
Yeah,
wooden people.
A bunch of wooden people walking around the exact same way.
With their dead eyes.
With their dead eyes. Everybody's got the same set of teeth in their head.
Yeah.
they didn't push the envelope on this one.
Yeah.
But they also did make like a whole galaxy, so like I don't know.
Yeah.
I've seen some people talk about like there are aspects of like that game they would like to see in like No Man's Sky, but then there's aspects of No Man's Sky like they'd like to see in this game kind of thing.
Yeah,
like,
and it's,
sure.
It's definitely not No Man's Sky. It doesn't have that kind of freedom.
Open.
So
open
it's like
galaxy.
An actual game.
Yeah, yeah. There's a lot of, you're going to go through menus a lot
okay.
to fast travel from place to place. You
gotcha.
Can't just fly around. You barely fly around in space at all because it would be boring.
Oh, okay.
But like any time you spend in space is going to be orbiting a planet and then maybe like somebody's going to attack you or you're going to get a random event happening like when you're between a couple planets. But it's not, don't expect to do a lot of flying. It weirdly doesn't really do that a whole lot.
For a game called Starfield, you're not really in the stars much.
Yeah. Huh.
Well, I look forward to the McElroy brothers doing a Monster Factory on this one. 6 months down the road so I can watch some gameplay of it.
I hope they get a lot of mods in there, because I didn't find the character creator to be that.
Oh, I'm sure they will. You know what? They'll probably make a half Garfield. They'll try to make Starfield the space cat. Knowing them.
Oh, what was that Star Trek race? Were there cat people?
Oh, and the doctor from Lower Decks is one of them.
Yeah.
And, well, it was from the
Star Trek, the animated series.
The animated series back in the 60s.
That did come back. Lower Decks came back the other day. We watched both the new episodes, and they were both very good Lower Decks stuff.
Continues to be Lower Decks.
Oh, good. Good.
They all got promotions, so they're not in the bunks anymore.
Oh, nice. All right. Hey, let's take a break. And when we come back, we will get into some news.
Long play is a radio show.
Long play is a lifestyle.
It is a radio show.
It's a lifestyle.
Hey, 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 calm down, you two. Long play is both a radio show and a lifestyle. If part of your very existence includes playing old vinyl records,
Oh, it is.
Then Long Play's the radio show for you. I invite you to tune in Friday nights at 11 and Saturday afternoons at 3 to see what it's like to have
the best of both worlds.
Hey, everybody, we're back. Those were some ads for some other great programming. Let's get into some news.
One and done.
Take, Harrison. I like it. Good work. All right. So we have some. God. Why is it that once the mics go on, we become mean to you, Josh?
I don't know. Why am I friends with you guys? You're just a bunch of bullies.
Aww. Aww.
But also, I am the crass out of pocket one 90 times out of 10 off mic. So I don't know, I guess I deserve it.
All right, so let's talk about some new stuff. Well, what do we have going on in the past like week and a half, I guess it's been, because we took a week off last week.
Yeah, well,
you know,
it's been a slow news time and continues
really
to be so, but we're gonna make the best of it here.
We're gonna do what we can.
We do it all for you people out there in the Nerd Overload community, and I am not stretching. Let's get into
Let's talk for at least 5 more minutes how we're not stretching this.
We are not stretching this. We got a full docket of news for you to get into.
So much news.
So much. I hope you like news, because we got so much of it coming out.
You're never going to believe how much news we have.
We got lots of news, listeners.
Oh, yeah. We are kind of rolling into a Roiland-esque.
We are, yes. We should probably.
Let's put a pin in that forever.
Yep.
And we'll get to the actual news.
That's actually news, Roiland.
Oh, yeah. They recasted Lemon Grab in.
They did.
Well, for Fiona and Cake, they made it drag queen. Was it Trixie?
Jinx Monsoon.
Okay.
Is now the Earl of Lemon Grab, which. Cool, fine.
Okay, whatever, sure.
Huh. How is Doctor Who?
Yeah, how was that, the Fiona and Cake? Has it come out yet, or is it?
It's out.
It is out.
I haven't watched it yet, though.
I haven't watched it yet either, but also Nicole's working her way through Adventure Time, and from everything I've seen in the trailers for it, you can't watch it without completing Adventure Time first.
Not what I've read.
I mean, it's got post-Ice King Simon.
Well, I mean, as long
and
as
adult,
you know.
And adult Finn.
As long as you know that.
So you watch the original Adventure Time or read the Wikipedia and character descriptions online, sure. But yeah, let's talk about some stuff.
We got some Nintendo news right off the top.
Our favorite thing.
Specifically Mario related on both of these.
Yeah.
They had a big Nintendo Direct, but a Mario specific Direct about Super Mario Brothers Wonder, the new 2D Mario game that's coming out. A lot of news about it weirdly made me less excited for, like, I still want it. I'm still going to get it when it comes out, but it made me less excited because it made me realize they're not going that wild with it.
Really?
Yeah. When I saw that original trailer, I'm like, oh, this is going to be so different. They're really thinking outside of the box. It turns out it's not that far outside of the box.
Really?
It definitely is different, but like they could do so much more.
It's not as trippy as that first trailer alluded to.
Yeah, like after you saw the elephant, you're like, well, what else? Like, what other animals are there going to be? Like, is Mario going to turn into a giraffe too? Is this the theme? No, it's just the elephant.
Oh,
just the one power up.
Yeah, they just thought the elephant would be cool. There's another one where he shoots out bubbles.
Yeah, I've seen some art of that, and I couldn't tell if that was official art or fan art.
Yeah, that's real. He turns pink and shoots bubbles.
Okay.
And you can jump on said bubbles, which, I mean, is kind of mechanically neat, but...
That almost turns them into kind of like a Mega Man-esque, like, was that one of the power-ups where you can make a platform kind of thing?
Oh, yeah, the little fan
the
platform.
The two or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And there's a drill one they showed, too, where he gets a little drill hat. And
okay.
He can drill into the ground. And
he is
also,
Mega Man. They are making a Mega Man.
He can also drill into the ceiling, too, and dig around. All the power-ups seem too powerful.
Okay.
Like, with the bubble, they're like, you can kill bad guys that weren't you normally couldn't. And then with the drill, it's like, your head's protected at all times while you have the drill. It's like, this seems really easy.
Yeah. Unless the level design is increased to match the power-up level. But it's Nintendo, so it's not going to be that.
They did make it so when you're playing multiplayer, you can occupy the same space.
Oh, that's kind of nice.
Which is good for level design, because then every platform won't have to be like 6 squares wide, so everybody can fit on it.
Yeah.
Speaking of multiplayer, all the characters play exactly the same.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so Mario, Luigi, 2 Toads, 2 Princesses, all the same.
And a Nabbit?
Yeah, well, Nabbit's there, and he's one of the ones that actually does play differently, because he's baby mode. He can't take damage from enemies. The only way he can die is if he falls in a hole. Yoshi, the 4 colors of Yoshi that are available are the same way.
Really?
Except they're even easier because they can eat everything and flutter jump.
Ah, oh, that's a shame.
So, like, if you liked Yoshi and still wanted, like, a real video game experience, you're out of luck on that one.
Gotcha. Bummer.
They added... mechanic called badges, where you can have your character wear different badges that have different effects, and a lot of them are like the special moves you would see the characters have in like Mario 2 and stuff.
Oh, okay.
So that's not completely gone, but now it's part of this badge system and any character can do it.
Okay, well, I guess I can kind of see.
Oh, so like the slow fall or the bigger jump.
Yeah, like
like you can equip your different characters with different badges so that you have a different like character for each situation kind of situation, or is it just like...
No, it's just you put on a different badge when you go into the level.
Okay. That's not as cool.
Yeah, which it's got like the duck jump from Mario 2 where you duck down and charge up. That's one of them. Mm. One of them lets you Spider-Man shoot vines out of you to grab onto walls, which is kind of neat.
Okay, that's kind of neat.
But yeah, and some of them aren't even that helpful. There's one that makes you invisible.
Oh.
So you can't see where you are, and also the enemies can't see where you are.
Weird. Okay. Huh.
Yeah, I don't like that.
Yeah, I don't know if I'm excited for this game as much.
Then it showed that Wonder Flower, the one that you get that makes the levels do weird stuff.
Yeah.
Every single level has one of those, and they all do something different.
Oh, weird.
Which is
okay.
Interesting.
That is kind of cool. Yeah.
The coolest one I saw was one that switches the perspective of the game to like almost top down.
Oh.
And suddenly you're running on the walls in the background instead of sideways on the foreground. That was cool. It seems like there's a lot of like wild stuff that's going to happen with that.
Huh.
It's a neat gimmick, but I don't know. I just thought there would be more.
Yeah.
I just thought they were going more outside the box with your 2D Mario. And instead what we're getting seems like just a couple steps up from a new Super Mario. It's not as big as what like Odyssey was.
Yeah, well, that's probably going to be the next the Mario game after this one is probably going to be the big, you know, Odyssey 2 or whatever they do with
whatever
it.
One they fired or not fired but replaced Charles Martinet for.
Yeah,
will be that one,
and it'll be on the new Switch 2.
Yeah,
so
Switch U.
Yeah. Oh God. Can you imagine?
Let's hope they don't call it that.
Yeah.
Which they did. They released that video with Charles Martinet.
They did, yeah.
And Miyamoto, and it was a kind of a big nothing burger.
Papa Miyamoto?
Yeah. Apparently, every time Charles Martinet sees Miyamoto, he calls him Papa.
I mean,
why not?
It makes sense.
Yeah.
You know what? From now on, I'm going to call him officially on the show. He is Papa Miyamoto.
I'm going to call him Daddy.
but yeah, I mean, I'm still happy for Martinet that he's
getting a cushy
gig post retirement
out of it. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think they're just keeping him on the payroll so he doesn't do some sort of terrible parody movie.
I think so. I think that's really it. Yeah. So that no one can pay him to
do the Mario.
Do the Mario.
But, yeah. But
he will never swing his arms from side to side. You set him up and I knock him down. That's all it is.
But at least, you know, they're being cool about it. I don't know why they chose to do it. They don't say who's replacing him. They don't explain why they did it, because he can still do it. He in the video, he looks spry as all get out.
Yeah,
he looks like he can do the voice forever, but
that also doesn't mean he doesn't have something going on that he's not telling people.
Either that, or yeah, he's putting on a show for the camera, and otherwise
he might be getting sick, or he just might be getting tired.
He just might not want to
do it anymore.
Yeah.
I feel like it was 100% Nintendo.
Oh, I think it was 100% Nintendo, yeah. But maybe it was a situation where he's like, well, you know, I make 10 times the amount of money going to cons and sit with my booth saying, hey, I'm Mario.
Going, woohoo.
Then going to Nintendo and actually recording the lines. So,
who knows? And they have him record lines so rarely anyway.
Yeah.
They reuse the same ones forever.
Yeah.
They still use lines from the GameCube days in games now.
They do. Yep. So.
Thank you for playing my game.
It's weird. It's a weird situation, and we'll probably never know what really is going on.
We will never know. But you know what? That's okay. We don't have to know everything.
It seems like everybody involved is okay with it, so we don't have to worry about it.
Exactly. That's that's a good point.
Yeah,
that's a good
point. It doesn't seem like anybody's getting you know, screwed.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep. Hey, talking about video games, you want to talk about some fighting game stuff?
Sure.
We have two fighting game newses, and I guess I'll take that because I'm the fighting game guy.
Yeah, you're the fighting game guy.
First up, so Street Fighter VI has been slowly rolling out DLC characters, and this next one is going to be a brand new character named A.K.I, A.K.I, that is an anagram for something.
Oh, I didn't realize
that. It's a mystery.
Yeah.
Anaconda...
Don't want none.
And but she
killing infusion.
It's got to be something lame like that because she's based on a Street Fighter V character named Fong, F-A-N-G, who was also an anagram for something. And it was his was also incredibly lame. I'm gonna look it up here in a second. But like Fang in Street Fighter V, her whole thing is poison and damage over time. Her whole deal is she hits you with a bunch of quick strikes that poison you, that do constant damage until you land a hit on her. But then she also has a lot of dodge and parry mechanics so that she also can't get hit. So it's basically poison your opponent and then run away for the rest of the match.
She slithers on the ground like a snake on her back, and it's the best.
She does a full snake thing. Yeah, it's pretty great. It's pretty great. But yeah, it's the character. She's visually very interesting. She has a weird, like, upside down Guile haircut.
Yeah, she's got a weird mushroom haircut, which is like
poison mushrooms.
Yeah, yeah, which is like the one thing that keeps me from being like totally all in is their weird haircut. But overall, I'd rather have an interesting looking character than one that one that hits all the cool notes, you know?
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
you're allowed to look a little weird.
We need to have the weirdos. I love having weirdo characters.
If we didn't have the weirdos, we'd never have Blanca.
Exactly.
Well, I'm looking him up, but I'm not seeing what the anagram means.
Farts and ranged. No, I missed the N. I can't spell.
Fang stands for Fantastic Asian Notorious Gang.
What? Those are definitely words.
But he's just one dude.
He is the leader of a subsect of Shadaloo that are all poison masters. That's his whole deal.
He looks like, in this picture I'm looking at, he looks like Judge Doom from Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
Oh, he does. Yeah. And he was incredibly annoying.
Wearing like some like kung fu garb.
Yep, he was very annoying, and it was weird because all of his moves were based on birds. You know, the most poisonous of animals.
I don't want to think about venomous birds.
But
terrifying.
But no, Aki looks great. I'm really looking forward to her. And after Aki is released, the next one, in theory, is going to be Akuma. A nice. New version of Akuma. And that's going to be great because everybody loves Akuma. The other one is on the other side of the dial, Mortal Kombat. They've rebooted their whole universe again. Basically
Mortal Kombat 1.
Any character that was killed off in continuity is back, and everyone's fair game. And they have they're starting to stunt cast some of the voice actors and actresses.
Again. Yeah, like they did last time.
Last time they used Rowdy Ronda Rousey as Sonya Blade, and she was terrible.
Yeah, the results were horrifying.
The results were not as good. Although they did also cast Kari Hiroyuki Tagawa as Shang Tsung from the original, the first Mortal Kombat movie.
Yep.
And he was like pitch perfect, 100%. He is Shang Tsung.
That's because he's a real actor.
Well, that too.
Ronda Rousey is not a real actor.
No, not especially.
The closest she got was wrestling.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you'd think if you could do wrestling acting, you could do Mortal Kombat.
Well, here's the thing.
She's not even good at
she
the
was
wrestling
terrible.
Thing.
She was terrible on the mic. She tried to be a Roddy Piper analogous, but it didn't. She's terrible on the mic. But no, they have cast Megan Fox, a real actress, as the voice of Nitara, a real Mortal Kombat character. I swear, you guys, it's real.
That was in one game.
Nitara the Vampire Lady was in one game, and then she was a jobber in the most recent Mortal Kombat movie.
She died almost immediately.
She was one of the first ones to die, yeah.
Was it Deception that had Nitara in it?
I believe so. It was something like that. But yeah, so they are...
I liked her because I like cool vampires.
Yeah. And I think Megan Fox can definitely do a good job portraying the voice of cool vampire lady.
Yeah, she can vamp it, be vampy.
Sure.
I mean, she did it for Jennifer's body.
The fact that they're bringing in Nitara and they're bringing back some of these other characters, it's like they're bringing everybody back. It's like everybody's coming
Everyone
back.
Everyone is here.
Everyone is here. I still don't know about the universe's least favorite character, Shu Hao.
I thought you were going to say Curtis Stryker.
Stryker is a striker. Stryker is an assist in this.
A cameo.
He is a cameo with a K. Yeah. Yeah. Because anything that starts with a C has to be a K in Mortal Kombat.
Yeah, because it's Mortal Kombat.
Yeah.
Have they done Bo Raicho yet, the Puke Fart Man?
I haven't seen anything with Bo Raicho, the Puke Fart Man yet, but I'm sure it's coming.
The fact
and it's probably going to be a young version because they've like de-aged all the characters well. So he's going to be a young Poop Fart Man.
When I was a young boy.
A fart boy. Did he have a fart move?
He had
a throw up move. I know that for sure.
He had a stunning fart move. He had a acid vomit move. Yeah.
This is Mortal Kombat, everybody.
Yeah. But Raicho, who was named after the Spanish word borracho, which means drunk guy.
Wow.
He's an Asian martial artist named after a Spanish word.
I hate fighting games.
Yeah, he's the drunken fist fighter too. So he's
very
like,
drunken fist.
He's always like wobbling around and stuff.
Yeah, that's his whole thing. But no, he's actually an elder god. He's a lesser elder god on the same level as Raiden in previous games.
Huh.
Like he is like the Mortal Kombat universe version of Bacchus. Essentially, he's like the god of partying and drunken martial arts. Yeah, that's kind of his whole shtick.
And then they let it just kind of get away from itself with the farting.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if you're gonna have a fat guy drunk and puking everywhere in your fighting game, might as well make him fart.
We already went that far. Might as well.
Yeah. But no, I'm really interested in seeing who else they pull from the depths.
Did they make Booger Man?
They did.
Yeah, he's basically Booger Man.
Although Booger Man was a clay fighter character eventually.
But they could put him in Mortal Kombat if they wanted.
Yeah, I mean, those Midway characters are just floating around now that they're no longer a going concern.
But we'll start the campaign now. Put Booger Man in Mortal Kombat. Hashtag put
Booger Man.
why not? I mean, some of the DLC characters they're putting in are weird. Like, it's Omni-Man from Invincible.
Yep.
And the
Homelander.
Homelander from The Boys.
It's the same.
And
that's
Peacemaker.
It's the same thing.
Yeah.
It's bad Superman.
Yeah.
You've got two bad Supermans.
It's because Ed Boon wants to see these two bad Supermen punch each other.
I guess.
That's all it is. But then we have Peacemaker, which actually I think is going to be an interesting get.
That's a good fit, I feel like. He's
yeah.
Very Mortal Kombat.
And John Cena is doing the voice for him in the game. And he looks show accurate to
Peacemaker. Do you think they'll have an alternate costume where he's just in his underwear?
I wouldn't put it past him. Oh, speaking of, you know what? Megan Fox doing the voice there. So there's an alternate voice track. One of the skins for Johnny Cage. Johnny Cage is being played by his own thing. But there's an alternate voice track that Jean-Claude Van Damme is doing. Because originally, before Mortal Kombat was Mortal Kombat, it was originally pitched as a fighting game starring Jean-Claude Van Damme.
I remember you talking about that before.
Yeah. And
apparently he was such a pain in the butt to deal with. That's why Johnny Cage is such a joke character.
Yeah, that's it. But now that he has nothing else going on, he's...
Now that Mortal Kombat is bigger than him.
Than him. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. But yeah, it's going to be interesting. I still think the game, it looks good, but any in-game looks terrible. Mortal Kombat games look incredibly stiff to me.
Yeah.
I don't know why. They always do.
And this one still does. Yeah.
Yeah, it looks almost exactly the same as the other ones. Yeah.
And the cameos look silly if they don't hit, because then a guy just falls out and does like a move and then runs away.
Yeah, yeah. but that's fine. I like my Mortal Kombat silly.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean,
it's kind of the point, man.
It's over the top, it's got to be stupid over the top.
Well, yeah, that's Mortal Kombat at its core.
Yeah.
You know, you always had like stupid fatalities, stupid stage stuff.
I think a lot of people don't realize that too.
Yeah. I mean, you had like the babalities, friendship, animalities.
You know, a lot of people think it's like this hardcore cool thing.
And it's
like,
not.
It's never really been that.
They've been making fun of. Yeah. It's been just this side of parody for fighting games for a number of years. And it's like, yeah, it's so extreme that it loops back around to being funny.
Yeah.
I don't know. What deep cut Mortal Kombat character would you like to see in Mortal Kombat?
Meat.
Meat would be a good one.
He's a skinless
just
meat
the
man.
The flayed man. Yeah.
Cause it's in Mortal Kombat 4. They took the model from the fatalities when people get
their skin ripped off.
And then they just made that a character. Which,
yeah.
But put that gross meat man in there.
I'd like to see mocap come back.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah.
Oh, I forgot about mocap.
Everybody forgets about mocap. But yeah, I would like to see mocap come back. I'd like to see...
Also, meat just bled all over the stage.
Just very drippy. Yeah.
Wet slapping sounds all the time.
Drommen. Drommen, the stinky man, because he had flies flying around him, and the flies... The sound effect for the flies were mixed so poorly that it was deafening to play against him, especially if you're wearing headphones while playing, because the buzzing is just so screamingly loud.
They should do console specific characters for each console it releases on.
Oh, that would be great.
You mean like what Soul Calibur did?
Yeah, like Soul Calibur. So we should get PlayStation should get Kratos or Joel from Last of Us.
Sure, sure.
Kratos would make more sense.
Is there going to be a Switch version?
Yeah, it's not going to look good, so it's probably going to... Like, the Pikmin guy.
Yeah, Captain Olimar.
Captain Olimar.
Mario.
Yeah.
Mario ripping somebody's heart out.
Uh-huh.
Xbox can... Todd Howard. It can be Todd Howard.
It could just be Todd Howard, yeah.
Little Skyrim dragons.
Actually, the Doom Marine would be really awesome in Mortal Kombat.
I'm legitimately surprised they haven't put a Doom Marine in it.
I mean, he's in Fortnite.
It just dawned on me that would rule.
It would actually really work.
I mean, he's in Fortnite. I mean,
yeah.
But also, who isn't in Fortnite anymore?
Yeah.
Okay, so last thing. We're kind of running out of time, but I did want to mention Hayao Miyazaki.
He thought he was retired.
For the fifth time, or sixth, or seventh. But no, he's back. He's going to make another movie after The Boy and the Heron.
the you live like this? What's called?
Yeah. don't tell people I live like this. Yeah,
like that's the direct Japanese translation.
Oh, it's how do you live?
Yes, how do you live?
How do you live? But yes, I've seen the memes of you live like this.
It very much has a don't tell anyone I live like this vibes.
Yeah.
They were very smart to localize it as the boy and the heron too.
Yes, absolutely. Miyazaki, who is in his 80s, who is fueled solely by cigarettes, coffee, and the hatred for his son, is going to come back and make another film.
You said he's got more ideas, so he's going back to the office.
Sure. You know, well, fine. Whatever.
I think the world's better for it.
If the quality of his output had diminished, then I would say, okay, now it's time for him to retire. He keeps making bangers.
Yeah, yeah.
As long as he's making good movies.
I don't think he's done a bad one.
It's not killing him.
As long as
his films are better than his son's. That is Freeloader.
There are two Ghibli movies I don't really care for.
Which ones?
Ponyo.
Ponyo. One of my least favorites.
Yeah, sure.
Ponyo and Tales of Earthsea.
Well, that his son did Tales of Earthsea.
Oh, yeah, Goro made that one.
Yeah, why it sucks.
So that's why it sucks.
Okay.
Yeah. No, you're supposed to hate that one.
Yeah. I think Ponyo is fine, but it's a little too kiddie for my taste, is what...
The big conceit I have with Ponyo is the whole thing of, like, asking a six-year-old if they truly love something.
That is weird.
I'm like, that's dumb.
That is weird.
At least most of the other Ghibli love interest type characters are like adult-ish, or at least...
Or sentient cat statues.
Or forest spirits, or kidnapped princesses, or whatever.
Pigman in a plane.
I do remember feeling a little weird about that in Ponyo.
Yeah, I was never a Ponyo guy myself.
It always felt like the one for babies.
Yeah.
Like, it's like the Finding Nemo of...
Kinda, yeah.
Of
yeah.
the Miyazaki milieu.
Yeah. And it's a shame about Tales of Earthsea, because I like the books.
Oh,
I like
yeah.
that Ursula went
I mean,
on books.
But
they gave it to that, bastard Goro Miyazaki.
I don't know, the story was just everywhere, and I felt... I don't know. I felt nothing for like the prince's plight in the movie, and I'm like, eh.
That's because Goro made it.
Yeah. That horrible waste.
But like, you know, pretty much everything else is
I'm sure he's a wonderful. I'm sure he's a very wonderful man. But
I don't know.
It's so funny because Hayao Miyazaki has said in multiple like interviews how much he hates his son and how much of a disappointment he is.
That's got to be really hard.
It's so mean. I can't.
But also it's really funny. Yeah. And it's not supposed to be. Yeah. But it's really funny to me that this guy, he's like, I make these loving, loving, beautiful films and I hate my son.
Well, not only, it's like that joke that people always make, like, you know, like comparing like Miyazaki and like Junji Ito, where it's like, Jujito makes these horribly ugly horror mangas and stuff.
And he's just the sweet, nice guy.
He's a sweet guy. He's all bubbly and colorful.
He loves his cats.
He wears color. He's fun.
He reminds me of Larry from Pokemon Scarlet and Violet. a normal dude.
Yeah, and then you've got Miyazaki, who makes these beautiful pictures, and he is just a
crotchety old man.
Yeah.
Who just hates life and everyone, and probably you if he met you.
Yeah, he's so unhappy. Like, he's sitting there just like with a cigarette hanging out of his mouth talking about how much he hates life. And I'm like,
well, the famous quote, anime was a mistake.
Yeah.
Came from Hayao Miyazaki.
I think I read somewhere he didn't actually say that.
Oh, he didn't actually say that? Okay, because I thought that was in like a documentary or something like that.
It might be taken out of context.
Oh, that might have been.
Maybe. There's something about it I've read that's not exactly
but
true.
But you know what? I would rather him actually have said it.
I would believe that he said that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it
well, no, it was taken out of context because the second part of the sentence is anime was a mistake, especially my awful child Goro's anime.
And it wouldn't be so funny if the movies were also, they are bad.
Right.
like that earwig in the witch or whatever.
Yeah, terrible.
That was really bad.
That was really bad.
Oh, yeah.
That miniseries they did for Amazon, that was terrible.
The dirt worst. Yeah. No, I mean, he's right. His son's anime is bad.
He's right, but he's not supposed to say it.
He's saying the quiet part out loud.
I think the best thing he said about Tales from Earthsea was that it is an earnest film.
I bet Hayao Miyazaki wakes up every day and calls his son and says, "I hate you." Just
and then Gora's just like, "Oh, this is my dad again."
Thanks, Dad. Talk to you tomorrow. Okay.
His name and his phone is Bastard Son.
Just disappointment.
Yeah.
This guy. Poor Goro Miyazaki. Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't envy him at all.
No. No.
I mean, at least he gets to make the movie, his bad movies.
That's true. That's true. I mean, how hard would that be to live like in the shadow of such a legendary?
Oh yeah.
Oh, it'd be terrible. Especially, yeah, kind of.
Your
art is never going to live up to his expectations.
Yeah, exactly. You're always going to be constantly living in their shadow. It's like if, like, you know, I don't know, like Walt Disney's kid or something, like tried to like come up behind him or something.
Sure.
No, I'm trying to find an analog. Well, that,
no,
that,
I get it. Yeah,
that,
I get
and
it.
And Goro doesn't get to work with the talent that Miyazaki did.
Sure.
Like when Miyazaki was making all his more famous ones, he had people like Hideaki Anno and like all these like great animators who have all now gone
and done
their own things
and building their own legacy.
And because Goro has
Hayao has
said in interviews how much Goro sucks, he now can only work with people that are willing to look past what his dad says.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I imagine a lot of up and coming animators go to Goro Miyazaki, you know, and go, doesn't he suck? Doesn't his dad hate all of his art or something?
Oh, but a lot of them were like, well, it's all Miyazaki.
Oh, you worked with Miyazaki?
I worked with a Miyazaki.
Fair, yeah. All right. So with that, I think we're going to go ahead and wrap things up for the week. You have been listening to Nerd Overload. Thank you very much for tuning in. You can find us each and every day over at nerdoverload.com.
If you want to turn into a eternal river rather than watching a Goro Miyazaki movie, you can find us on Nerd Overload Now at Facebook, Twitter, Twitch, Instagram, and Patreon.
You can email us at staff@nerdoverload.com.
You can give us a call on the Nerd Overload hotline. The number is 419-561-5556. Leave us a message and we'll play it on the show.
What's your favorite Ghibli movie?
That's what I was going to say.
Hey.
And also, make sure your message is something other than 20 seconds of silence.
Yeah.
Because we can't play that on the show.
What's your favorite Miyazaki movie? And if you were Hayao Miyazaki, what kind of awful things would you say about your son?
I don't know.
You can find all of our back episodes on various podcast apps such as Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Play, and more. Finally, I'd like to thank Parker for helping us out over on the Facebook page and David Pencil for the use of our intro and outro. You can find more of his stuff over at davidpencil.com. So again, thank you all for tuning in, and we will be back next week.
That was an earnest episode.